Okay, now that we've walked through ANOVA and looked at multiple comparison tests, what happens if we looked at those normal plots and decided that they weren't normal? So if what that happens, we obviously we'd switch to a nonparametric approach, and the nonparametric test is called the Kruskal-Wallis test. So in the event we have a violation of our assumptions, such as a non-normality, but it's not only a non-normality, there's actually a couple places this could happen. If I'll come back to that in just a second. We can complete this test known as the Kruskal-Wallis test, which I'm going to abbreviate as the KW test. And like many nonparametric tests, the KW test is actually based on the ranks of the data. Now, essentially what the KW test does is it's a lot like the Wilcox and rank sum. Remember a discussion for the Wilcox and rank sum set, two independent data groups. We put them together as if they're one big data set, but we remembered which group they came from. Then we ranked them. Then we separated the ranks back out, and then we essentially did a two-sample t-test using the ranks. And that's exactly what we're doing here. The Kruskal-Wallis test is essentially the same sort of a thing. We're going to take all these groups, throw them together, but remembering where each data value came from, we're going to rank the whole big group together. And then once they're ranked, we're going to separate the ranks back out into the original groups and then do an ANOVA on the ranks. That's really essentially what the Kruskal-Wallis test is all about. But when we do this, we need to modify our hypothesis test, because now with the ranks, we're actually talking about the median. So we say theta 1 equals theta 2 equals theta 3. Now, I stopped at 3 because I'm still going to use this diet data that we used for the ANOVA. Because remember, we looked at the normal plots, there's a couple of them went, oh, I don't know about that. Well, if you felt it was not normal, then you would have switched and done the Kruskal-Wallis. The alternative would still be at least one of these guys is not equal, somebody's different, and alpha is 0.05, just like we did before. So now we would go ahead and do the Kruskal-Wallis. But before I actually walk through that process, there's two situations that you would be using this. Number one, actually I should say three. The most obvious is probably is when you're interested in the medians to begin with. Number two, if you have a violation of the normality assumption. Sorry, starting to write too fast there. And number three, the F-test for similar variances. Had a small p-value. In other words, if you rejected H-naught on the F-test. Because remember, the null hypothesis was that the variability of, say, the largest group and the variability of the smallest group are similar. And the alternative hypothesis is that the variability of the larger group and the variability of the smaller group are different. We needed to fail to reject to say that they were similar. If we rejected, then we're saying they're different, but we need them to be the same for the ANOVA. So if you have a violation of the similarity assumptions, the equal variance assumptions, then you do a Kruskal-Wallis. Or if you have a violation of normality, then you do Kruskal-Wallis. And less common is if you're specifically, I suppose, interested in the medians to begin with. So going back to TC stats, under the mini samples, select Kruskal-Wallis and select all three and update it. There's your test statistic and here's your p-value. P-value is 0.0177. Therefore, I would reject the null hypothesis. and conclude a difference between the groups. Now, for this course, if we reject this null hypothesis and say that somebody's different on the Kruskal-Wallis, we're going to stop there. We're not going to continue on and do a multiple comparison test in a non-parametric approach. We will only do the multiple comparison test of Fisher's LSD if we have an ANOVA and we find a difference. But notice in this case, we would have rejected either way. The normality assumption was not a gross violation. Maybe a minor violation there, but it wasn't a gross violation. And those p-values were very, very close together. So in reality, it wouldn't matter which way I went. I would have come to the same conclusion. However, once again, for this course, the advantage of doing ANOVA, if that's what you decided, is that you can do multiple comparison and figure out which group is different. Now, we're not going to do a Kruskal-Wallis first, hoping to reject and be done, so you don't have to mess with the multiple comparison. You're going to follow the proper procedures. In my course, for my students, if you don't justify why you think is a violation of the normality or the similar variances, is if you just jump to Kruskal-Wallis, you're not going to get any credit. You need to go through and apply the proper thought process in a proper analytical techniques. Apply the proper analytical techniques to the data. No shortcuts.